All right, I'm not singling out single people, but just for a moment for the illustration. If you're married, stick your hand nice and high in the air. I always love the hesitating ones. You're like, if you're not sure, if your wife's hand is up, that's you, okay? You want to move quickly, okay? You can put your hands down now, okay? Do you remember that day when you went from being like dating or whatever you called it, depending on how old you are, okay? If you're like courting, if you're pre-70s or something, but do you remember that day you went from dating to engaged? I mean, because no matter how nerdy you are, there had to be a point where you mustered up, right, the guts and the gall and the faith to just get down on your knees and take out a ring. This is free, single man. You got to write this down. You need to buy one, okay? And actually, with trembling hand, probably like me, ask the question. Because I remember that day. Do you remember that day? Where are you at? Do you remember that day? Of course you do. If you're married, you remember that. I remember that day. I was running a comedy club, and so I had to do something a little tricky. I had a friend who had this $200,000 motorhome, and he's like, Joel, if you want to, like, because I wanted to create Phantom of the Opera. She liked that movie. And you know, there's a scene where he goes through on a gondola. It's kind of messed up to think about it now. But anyway, why did I do that? But anyway, and there's like all these, I don't know what you call them, like tiki little tea lights. Yeah, I don't know if they were tiki torches. That's Survivor, but thank you. There were all these like tea lights all over the place on the stage and mirrors everywhere, and it just looked amazing. And her favorite singer was the dude that sang that song, Michael Crawford, in the original cast in London. And so I thought, what if I could recreate that, but not singing that song, because that's a bit dark and gloomy, but one of his songs. And so what I did was I got this motorhome from a friend of mine. It was like brand new in the day, like we're talking 19 years ago now. Next year's our 20th. And I got these, I had to take her out and then bring her to it. I couldn't light all the candles in this motorhome an hour before, so I couldn't light them because I thought if I lit them, goodbye motorhome, right? By the time, so I got these comedians to go in there and peel, bad story already, I know, peel off rose petals from a dozen roses, put them all over the floor and everything. This thing was huge. And then put these little light, all these little tea lights all over the place. And then I had mirrors in there and I had music playing and I got her inside this motorhome, which is really kind of creepy because we went down this dark road and I'm like, okay, get out. We're going to go through the woods and find a motorhome, which was weird now. I don't recommend this. But we did it. And then we got into this motorhome and I opened the door and it was dark. Except, no, not dark, with all the lights, it was, I mean, the lights were off, but all it was with these little tea lights all over the place, and she starts to figure out, what is going on? And then I hit play on a, what we call a cassette recorder. What that is, youth, young adults, youth, is, never mind. Anyway, we play music, you know what I'm saying? And it was this song by Michael Clayderman, what are you doing for the rest of your life? That's all I got. And yeah, no one claps, and that tells me a lot. But listen, nobody is rocked by that. Okay, and I got down on one knee, and I pushed this button. Everything was electric. Like, out came this compartment. I pulled this glass out with this ring box in it. And I got down, and I proposed to her. I said, will you marry me? And she said, I'll think about it. No, she said yes. She said yes. But I want to imprint this in your mind because many, if you're married, you know that moment. You know that moment where you took a ring out and you presented it, hopefully. And you were, at this point, the ring meant that you were, you went from dating to engaged. And it meant that you were committed, but you weren't married yet. You were committed to this person, but you weren't married. Well, today we're looking at this grand topic of baptism. And I could think of no greater way to kind of illustrate this, that baptism is like that ring. It's a symbol that is hugely significant. It's meant to show the world that you love, you trust, and you are dedicated to the Lord. It's like a wedding ring. Let's say I'm not married right now, but if I put a wedding ring on the finger, shout out your answer if you know the right answer. Would that make me married? No, that doesn't make me married. Of course not. Similarly, guys, if I'm baptized in a church, and some of you might need to hear this, that does not make me a true believer in Christ. And some people think that. They say, well, you know, if I'm baptized, then I'm saved. No, you're just wet. If you're saved, baptism is a picture of your salvation, but it's not your salvation. It's a picture of just like Jesus going into the grave, being buried in the old life, if you will, and then coming out of the grave. So we're buried in the water in our old life, and we come up in newness of life. It is a commitment, and it is also, if you will, a statement of intent. Now, imagine if I was married, though. My wife and I really did go through the marriage ceremony, but I just have my ring on my finger. Would that mean I wasn't married? No. Of course, I would still be married. Similarly, I can be a believer in Christ and not be baptized, and my sins are still paid for and forgiven. But imagine I'm truly married and I really, really love my wife. Here's my point. Would I wear my wedding ring? Sure I would. I would do it because I love my wife, and I would, as a statement, want everyone in the world to know, in the same way as we get into this passage, if you've trusted Christ to save you from sin, he's your Lord, he's the joy of your life, and you want everyone to know about it. That's what baptism is all about. It's a symbol, but it's also a statement that says, I've trusted in Christ for my salvation, and now I'm committed to living for him. Now, hold that thought. As we jump into Matthew's gospel, it's good to know that some 30 years has passed between chapters 2 and 3. And scholars even suggest that 18 years have passed between where we left last week, verse 12, and now verse 13. That helps set the context a little bit. Why? Well, the question some people ask is, well, where's Jesus been? I mean, what's he doing, right? I mean, it's 30 years since birth, 18 years since the last story we have of him as a young boy. And so, you know, he's not, I can tell you right now, he's not in Tibet learning from the ascended masters if it was a Hollywood movie, right? It'd be like, oh, he was training in India, flying carpets. And no, none of that. None of that. Do you know what he's doing? He's doing what he's always done. He's being a carpenter. And we know this because the Bible tells us. The Bible says in Luke's gospel in Mark, he grew up in Nazareth. It says he came to the synagogue on the Sabbath as was his custom. What does that mean? He always did this. So we learn about Jesus. There's a stability of he's always in church, if you will, in an Old Testament sense. He's going through and he's working hard as a carpenter. And he swept the floor of the carpentry shop. And at some point, after 18 years of doing this job, some point in the week before he shows up here in verse 13, at some point, he sort of puts away the broom and the planes and the hammers and the awls. He takes that apron off, that apron that he always wore. He hangs it up in his dad Joseph's shop. Who knows? I'm just having a bit of fun here, but who knows? Maybe he gives his mom a look and says, I gotta go. There's a call on me now. But he moves from this carpentry position to step out into the public call of God that he has in this ministry at some point in this week before we enter these verses here. For the last time, he just kind of walks out of the shop and he begins this ministry. Now let's dive into verse 13, where there's literally thousands of people, like Pastor Dan showed us last week, in a desert, and they're just, and this is amazing, they've come all this way from the wilderness to be baptized by John. Verse 13, can I just say one thing? Because this doesn't often get mentioned. And I was like, I forgot to write it down, but I just want to say, wasn't worship awesome? Seriously? I'm at the back just giving her. I mean, aren't you so thankful we have great worship and sound ministry here in this church? Praise it. Can we just, yeah. The Bible says, mark well those who do well among you. So I meant to say that. Verse 13, then Jesus came from Galilee to John at the Jordan to be baptized by him. This is fun. Some of us just returned from Israel, and while we were there, we had the neat experience of having a baptism service at the Jordan River. It's a really cool place. And as I was preaching, I became aware that more than usual, we had gathered quite a large crowd, at least twice what we had. And we were a group of 45. And I don't know what it was, but I just felt like the Holy Spirit was like, there are non-believers here. You see, the Jordan River now is this cool spot, but it's definitely changed a bit in my mind, where it's a little more commercialized. So there's a lot of people that are flowing through there. So while we will go there only if somebody in the group says, I haven't been baptized yet, I want to be baptized, we'll go there. Well, two people in our group said they want to be baptized. And you know what I'm talking about. So it's really cool. So we get these long white robes on and we go down into the water, which is the coldest water on the planet. It's in Israel. You wouldn't think so, but it is. And you're in this water and you have the two baptismees over here. And there's our 45 in our group. And then all of a sudden, this tour group kind of shows up and just circles in the whole enclave. And I just get this sense from the Lord, start preaching the gospel. And I'm supposed to just do a little baptism thing. I start preaching louder and louder because I want the people in the balcony to hear this. And it's a full-on gospel presentation. The poor people getting baptized standing right here, like, why is he yelling at us? But I just want to share this. You need to hear these stories. It was at this powerful moment. And I remember this little Asian guy. He pulls out his camera and he starts moving closer to me while I'm preaching the gospel. I didn't do an altar call, but I did a challenge at the end. And we baptized a couple people. One of them, a good friend's of the Kramer, his daughter got baptized. And so this leads us into this verse because look, it says this. We came from the Galilee region to the Jordan, that Jesus came from Galilee to the Jordan, and that's exactly what our tour group did, except we were faster than Jesus because we were on a bus. Now, it says he came from the Galilee region to the Jordan. Now, then he uses this word, to be baptized. If you got a pen, note takers, jot this down, to be baptized by him. Underline the word baptize if you're a note taker or a student of the word, and I encourage you to do this. Close by, write the words sunken ship. Sunken ship. See, for you students of the word baptize is the Greek word. It's a very specific word, and I love how the Greeks have these picture words they use. It's the Greek word baptizo, baptizo, and it gives us the picture of a ship that has been sunk and has sunk to the bottom of the ocean and has been there so long that if you were to take out a chunk of the wood from this ship, you would find that it is so saturated with water that there are more water particles in that chunk than there are wood particles. Don't you love the Greek language? We read that, we go, yeah, baptized, awesome, dunked in water. But in their language, it's this picture of this ship so saturated that there's more of water in it than there is of wood. And this is what I want to suggest to you right off the bat today, friends, is that God is not simply interested in us just having relationship with him. Is he interested in us having relationship with him? Absolutely. Amen? But does he want it to just be, and you take the picture, if you will, of the wedding ring, the engagement ring, and the marriage, does he want it to just be a commitment? Well, okay, I'm committed to you. I mean, ladies, was it that romantic from your man when he proposed? He's like, I would like us to be committed. And that even sounds weird, you know? You need to be committed to me. We know inherently, all of us, you know, put Hollywood aside, that there's a desire for a romance and a desire and a passion and a love. There should be a fire in that person's heart. And so when we read these words, I kind of want us to grab this idea that God is wanting us to be saturated today like the Savior. That Jesus is going to, we're going to see this picture of Jesus with the Spirit all over him. And he walks about, the Bible says, full of the Spirit. He goes about doing good everywhere. He's so saturated with the Spirit that more of the Spirit comes out through the life and the ministry of Jesus Christ. And that is what he is looking for from you and from me. Some of you right now, that picture of the ship, that might be you. You may be sunk in a situation or a circumstance instead of in the Savior. You might be in a situation right now, for some of you, where is something that you're buried in that's drowning you like the ship, yet the Bible says you need to be filled with his Spirit in spite of the situation. You need to be saturated in the Savior, and that's just because you're in it. Don't use that as an excuse to say, well, I can't walk in the Spirit. No, no, no. The evidence of the fruit of the Spirit should still be coming out. In fact, you need more of the Spirit when you're sunk in a situation or circumstance. You need more patience and love and peace and faith and gentleness. Maybe you need to hear that. Now watch what happens, verse 14. And John tried to prevent him. So Jesus comes and he says, hey, John, baptize me. But then this amazing word, John tries to prevent him saying, I need to be baptized by you. Are you coming to me? This is a big deal to me. How are you feeling if you're John? You've been baptizing people. You've been baptizing thousands of people, a baptism of repentance, not justification where they're made right with God, but just, hey, I'm sorry, God, for my sins, because Jesus hasn't come yet, so they can't be justified, which, to take a big word and make it simple, it's just as if I'd never done anything wrong. They can't have that yet because the cross hasn't happened. So he's just simply getting them to identify that they're sinners, that just because they're Jewish, they don't inherit justification with God. They're sinners who need to say, step one. But here's what I think is so understated and missed by commentators. You're John. Think with me about this. You're John. You're baptizing people because they're sinners in need of cleansing. And you've already, the Bible tells us in other gospel accounts, identified earlier on that Jesus is, in fact, the Savior who comes to take away the sins of the world, the Lamb of God. You pointed that out earlier as John. When Jesus showed up, you're like, that's the one. And now here he comes back to you in the waters, and he walks to you and he says, hey, you need to baptize me. And then this amazing word, John tried to prevent him. And I kind of understand it. If there's ever an I'm not worthy passage or moment in all of history, wouldn't you agree it's this moment here? I mean, if you've ever felt like, man, I do not qualify to baptize God. First off, I'm baptizing people to signify that their sins are washed away. So how on earth can I baptize the perfect, sinless, spotless Lamb of God? I am not worthy. Let me help you with this. Imagine Einstein asking you to help him with a math problem. Or LeBron James saying, hey man, I want you to work on my jump shot with me. You catch where I'm going, right? Or maybe Donald Trump asks you how to write an inappropriate Twitter post. These people are expert at these things. They don't need your help. How qualified would you feel? How inadequate would you feel? I mean, really, it's like if our South African worship leader said, Joel, can you help me work on my South African accent? You get what I'm trying to say here, right? It's ridiculous. And so John is within human understanding. We get here why it says he tried to prevent Jesus. What's even more interesting to me in my studies was that the Greek verb is in the imperfect tense. The word prevent here, if you've got a pen, you maybe circle or highlight it here. This is really interesting to me because it is literally written in the tense that suggests that he kept trying to prevent him over time. Doesn't that change the picture a little bit? I mean, think with me, church. Can you picture this? I'm a visual guy. Can anyone else see this? Jesus comes to you. You're John the Baptist. Jesus said, I need to be baptized by you. And then he bends his knees like we train them. And he puts his hand out like we train them. He starts to lean back. And John's like, no, you're not going down. And then he does it again. And he's like, no, you're not going to do this. And no, you're not going under the water. That's literally what the Greek tense says. Isn't that an amazing picture? And what are you, if you're one of the bystanders, because there's thousands watching, you're just like, you're thinking, what is going on here? And there is literally a strength to the word prevent here. And I kind of want us to catch that because you almost have to read it again. Read these words. He is trying to prevent Jesus, which brings me to a bit of a side application. Friends, question, what are you trying to prevent Jesus doing in your life? Where is someone trying to love you and you're not letting it? Trying to give to you and you're not letting it? Trying to pray for you, grow with you, teach you, be there for you, even correct you and you're like, no, Jesus, that won't work. I'm angry, I'm not ready, I'm busy. Oh, you may not know it's actually Jesus at work. But I wonder how many times we have actively put a stop to what Jesus is trying to do in our own life. Because we cut something off or deny or where we're rigid or we're stuck in our ways. Now watch specifically how John resists because it's found in the next words here. He tries to prevent Jesus, and then he gives his logic. This is the next line. I, John, need to be baptized by you, and you're coming to me. I found this so fascinating. How many of you have ever had this thought? Well, Lord, you got this backwards. Lord, this situation, it's switched. This is reverse of how it should go. Lord, the way this is unfolding, this is the reverse of what I thought. Sure you have. I know I have. You thought the Lord would wipe somebody out and they got a promotion at work. You know, you maybe came to the front for healing and you're up there at the same time someone else is praying for healing and an elder is praying for them. And then you found out they got healed of their cold, but you're not healed of your way more severe thing. And you're like, what on earth? Lord, you switched it. That makes no sense. They weren't even hardly sick. And they got healed like that. And I'm still stuck with this thing. How many of you have had this situation where you're like, man, I'm praying for my finances and they're getting worse and worse. And then I got buddy over here who's rocking it in the recession, just bought a new car and an $800 espresso machine. And you're like, come on. Let's just be realist for a second. Can we, church? Have you ever had that? I have, sure. Where it just feels like this is injustice. Can't you see this, Lord? You've switched it. You've flipped it. You got it backwards. That's what John is saying. But listen, friends, sometimes in life, God will switch it and we don't have to understand it. Turn with me in your Bibles if you got it. I think it's a cool example of this to Genesis, first book in the Bible, Genesis 48. The best commentary on the Bible is the Bible. I just encourage you to keep in the word, church. Genesis 48, cool story. Jacob, of course, his name got changed to Israel, gets reconnected with his son Joseph, has been missing for years in Egypt. You know the story, true historical account. And we join in verse 14. Joseph finally gets to reconnect with his dad, Jacob / Israel. And in this moment, Joseph comes with his two sons, Ephraim and Manasseh. Manasseh and Ephraim, and he wants Jacob to bless the firstborn son. It's called primogeniture. It's the law, the Hebrew law, that the firstborn son gets the right hand of the grandfather on him, and when the right hand goes, woo, all the blessing goes on the firstborn son. The left hand's just kind of there. It's like you bring your second son in and it's sort of like leftovers, if you will, from Thanksgiving. I was like, and bless him too. You know, oh, bless his heart. That's the second hand. That's really what that means in the Hebrew law. And so Joseph comes and it says, verse 14, Genesis 48, then Israel stretched out his hand. That's Jacob, who got renamed Israel. His right hand and laid it on Ephraim's head, who was the younger. Do you see that? This is wrong. And his left hand on Manasseh's head, guiding his hands knowingly, for Manasseh was the firstborn. See that? It got flipped. Now watch verse 17. Now when Joseph saw his father laid his right hand on the head of Ephraim, it displeased him. So he took hold of his father's hand to remove it from Ephraim's head to Manasseh's head. And Joseph said to his father, not so, my father, for this one is the firstborn. Put your right hand on his head. But his father refused and said, I know, my son, I know. He shall become a people, and he shall also be great. But truly his younger brother shall be greater than he, and his descendants shall become a multitude of nations. So he blessed him that day, saying, by you Israel will bless, saying, God make you as Ephraim and Manasseh. And thus he set Ephraim before Manasseh. Did you see that? God, the picture we have, if you will, Israel switched his hands. And I think this picture is in the Bible because it teaches us that Joseph here is just dealing with the reaction to the injustification of the moment. I mean, this is wrong. Lord, you've got this wrong. It was supposed to be the firstborn son, and it got flipped. And it brings us back to the reality, friends, that God is not only interested in the outcome of certain things in our lives, he's interested in the reaction. Maybe you need to hear that today. Perhaps some of you, like myself, you're so destination-oriented, you think, well, I need to get here and I need to get there. And when I get that job, and for some of you, maybe it's that spouse, that change, that thing that I want to buy. Once I get that thing that I so desperately need, then I'll be all good. But what if God switched it? What if the Lord flipped it on you? And yet others of you, you're in that right now. You're like, this is not how this was supposed to go. And I love the words of Israel here, Jacob, which is really a picture of the Father God. When it gets flipped, he goes, I know, son, I know. And maybe those are his words to you today. Maybe something you got into didn't work out and it's reversed on you. And you're thinking, God, do you see this? And his word to you is, I know, son, I know, daughter, I know. But my hand is still on you. And my hand is still for blessing. I think it's just a great reminder. And some of you, perhaps you're like, man, that's where I'm at right now, Joel. It's not going according to plan. And friend, rather than seeing his preventing hand, you need to trust in his prevailing plan. Rather than seeing that he's against you, know that the heart of the Father is always for you and that he knows. I think the best thing for us in suffering is the reality and the revelation that God knows. None of this catches him off guard. Your cancer, it's not gone past him. Your fight with that person, it's not lost on him. Your deep-seated issue, he's not unaware, and he is able to heal, and he is able to change, and he is able to move. I know, he says. I know. And we need to hear that in our lives. Okay, back to our account. John is preventing Jesus, arguing the right way with Jesus, thinks Jesus has it backwards, gives Jesus the proper logic, sees that Jesus has switched it and flipped it. And Jesus answers verse 15 and says to him, to permit it to be so now, for thus it is fitting for us to fulfill all righteousness. And then he allowed him. Man, that sounds a little Star Trek, doesn't it? Permit it to be so now. I tried that on a friend at work this week. Go for it. But what does it mean, permit it to be so now, for it is fitting? Well, John presents the scenario here. He says, this doesn't fit my thinking. It doesn't fit my liking. You have it backwards. And this is one of these areas, again, where he's saying, you know, I don't know that you get this, God. And God says, guess what? My ways aren't your ways. My thoughts are higher. And so what permit it so now means is basically he's saying to John, let this happen. Because there's a bigger plan. There's a bigger thing at work here. And I'm not just fulfilling something which seems wrong. I'm actually fulfilling something which seems right. And it's a greater righteousness, if you will. Now, that's pretty deep, but I think it's a good thing for us to remember that God's plan and God's thoughts are higher than ours. That he says, I have a plan, and you need to do what? Permit it. Allow it. And how timely that can be for us when we're fighting against it and wrestling with the circumstances. We should be less like a matador, you know, fighting in an arena with the bull of life, and more like a sailor on a ship allowing, or on a sailboat, allowing the wind of the Spirit, yielding to what God is already doing and where he's already working to carry me along the path that he wants me on. Because listen, if you're a Christian, then this is true of your life. He who began a good work in you will be faithful to complete it. What's that mean? God will get each of you, each of us, no matter how much we can struggle, even with each other at times, if we're in Christ, we are in his sailboat and he's guiding us to completion. And the best thing we can do is stop fighting and start yielding to the leading of the Spirit in our life. Jesus says, permitted so, and John allowed him. People say, why did Jesus need to be baptized? Like, we get what John was wrestling with, right? Jesus was perfect. And in fact, John was like the first really apologetic minister to point that out. If you think about it, he identified that by resisting to baptize him because he was perfect. That's the first testimony in the Bible of someone going, no, you're perfect. And so why would he baptize him? So why? Well, he's, again, these words, it is fitting to fulfill all righteousness.
Now, this is a bit deep, I confess, but I just wanted to really like spell this out a bit. Evidently, I think Jesus saw his life as the fulfillment of all righteousness, and the fact that participating in a baptism of repentance, even though he had no sins to repent of, is part of that. It shows that the righteousness he wanted to fulfill was required just not of him, but of everybody. Every sinful man. And I was thinking about how Jesus read Isaiah 53 probably growing up in the synagogue, because they read it there. And Isaiah 53 becomes his life mission, if you know what I'm talking about. And in verse 11, he would have read this: by his knowledge shall the righteous one, my servant, make many others, is the idea, to be accounted righteous. And so the righteous one will cause many to be counted righteous. So the answer to the question of why did Jesus insist on being baptized is that this new people who are being gathered by John the Baptist on the basis of repentance and faith, not on the basis of Jewishness, if you will, would still need to be saved and justified, made right with God. And they would have to have a righteousness not their own, just like Paul said in Philippians 3, 8 and 9. We have a righteousness that didn't come from us. We can't just say sorry for our sins. We need to receive the righteousness of Jesus, what he did on the cross for those sins to ourselves. And that's important, because you can't just be someone that says, hey, I said sorry. Hey, I believe in God. The Bible says the demons believe in God. So what? Have you received the new life of Jesus to pay for your sins? Is your sorry directed towards the one who paid with his life on the cross? And that righteousness includes the fulfillment of all the righteousness in life and the life of Jesus. And so all the righteousness that would be required of men before the court of God, Jesus performed it all. And so he joins fallen humanity, if you will, and whom he's providing righteousness in sharing in their baptism. In other words, you could boil it all down and simply say, he followed in obedience to the law of the day, but he followed as a model for the people of the day so that they would receive all righteousness. Verse 16, when he had been baptized, Jesus came up immediately from the water, and behold, the heavens were opened to him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and alighting upon him. Can you see this picture? Isn't it cool? The heavens are open. He sees the Spirit coming down, descending like a dove and alighting upon him. It's this wild picture. The Bible never says that it was a dove. Obviously, we're a Calvary Chapel church. We use the symbol of the dove. We kind of think this is such a great moment that the power of the Holy Spirit comes down. But it wasn't actually a dove. It just was in the form of a dove. And that's important. Why? Because some of our more hyper-Pentecostal friends will also say, well, yeah, there's a baptism of fire too, because fire came down in Acts 2 upon the apostles. But it doesn't say that. It says like a fire. If fire came down, they'd all get their heads burnt, right? So it's important that we understand what the Bible says and doesn't say. And right here it says like a dove, the form. It looked, it came out of the heavens. The heavens were opened. And this is interesting, because John's gospel sheds light on this incredible event. In verse 32, he says, John bore witness saying, I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and he remained upon him. So John saw this. And so probably everybody saw the heavens open. And it's interesting, because in Luke's account in chapter 3, verse 21, it tells us the heavens were opened while Jesus was praying. That's a cool thought. So it gives it, when we piece them all together, John sees it, everyone sees it, Jesus is praying. As he's praying, the heavens are open. Add that to your prayer life. Think about that. As you're praying, the heavens are open. If you have some situation that's locked up that you think, I don't know what's going to happen here, are you praying? Because if there's a closed situation, guess what? It's not going to open until you're praying about it. And it's only when you begin to pray. And if you take the book of Ephesians, it's really cool how many times the word heavenlies comes up. He talks about our prayer, it going from the earthlies to the heavenlies, changing something in the heavenlies, and then coming back to the earthlies and affecting that change. Do you know that's happening? That when you pray, the heavens are opening? That's a cool thought. That it opens up situations, that it changes, and if you're not praying, it's not going to happen. Trapp said this, the commentator, he said, as he was praying, for prayer is the key of heaven, wherewith we may take out of God's treasury plentiful mercy for ourselves and others. It unlocks, it breaks loose, if you will. I love that. In other words, the heavens open up as we pray. And the dove, of course, is this beautiful symbol throughout the scripture of the Spirit of God. See, like a dove, the work of the Holy Spirit can be swift at times. You have some situation and you ask, Holy Spirit, come and move upon this. And all of a sudden, he can do in a moment what we can't do in a lifetime. And he just flips it and changes it for good. And situation, that's the work of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit, from the very beginning of the Bible, Genesis chapter 1, he's the action figure of the Bible, if you will. Wherever the Holy Spirit is, there's action. God the Father's there. He's Elohim in Genesis 1. It's plural. It means let us make man in our image. So it's God the Father and God the Son. But then what does it say about the Holy Spirit? He's hovering over the waters. Don't you love that? He's the action figure of the Trinity. Wherever the Spirit is at work, there is an action happening. And so one of the works of the Holy Spirit is that he can be swift. And like a dove, the work of the Holy Spirit can also be soft and gentle at times. And the work of the Holy Spirit brings peace at times. Like a dove, the work of the Holy Spirit is also harmless in your life. And like a dove, the Holy Spirit, that work of the Holy Spirit will always speak of love. And like the scriptures say, the Holy Spirit will testify of him, Jesus. So when the Holy Spirit is at work somewhere, you hear a lot about Jesus. That's important. And so Jesus is about to begin his public ministry, and he will do it in the power of the Holy Spirit. And I love this. Why? Because, church, listen, no miracles happen in the life of Jesus till after this moment. And I just want to say this for us too. No miracles in your life, no action in situations will change if you're living the Christian life in your own strength and power. But as you yield to the Holy Spirit's leading and power, there's an overflowing in your life that begins to move in love. And situations unlock and miracles happen. How we need to get back to the simplicity of the leading of the Holy Spirit. Charles Spurgeon said it this way. He said, it was the Spirit of God who gave success to Jesus' ministry. I don't know where you're at today, but perhaps you're in this place and you just quite honestly need a fresh touch of the Holy Spirit. Maybe today you need a fresh filling of the Holy Spirit. I would encourage you at the end to just either where you're sitting or come to the front and be prayed for, that the Holy Spirit would overflow and move upon your life afresh. Chuck Smith, the founder of Calvary Chapel, was famous for saying, what most people need is not another counseling appointment, but a fresh filling of the Holy Spirit. Isn't that good? That what we really need in our lives is not just, God, change this thing. God, fix me. God, I'm going in to get this problem solved. But what we really inherently need is the overflowing of the Holy Spirit again. That's what we need. We need the Spirit to overflow our lives. Verse 17, as we wrap up, and suddenly a voice came from heaven saying, this is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased. It's interesting. People say, well, the Trinity isn't in the Bible. You know, you've heard this argument. You know, where's the Trinity in the Bible? Well, the concept, friends, is all over the Bible. You have God's Son, Jesus. You have the Spirit descending upon him, and you have the Father speaking over him. I'd say that's pretty clear. I'm going to call up the band right now just to give you, as I give you a couple thoughts, then we'll close in worship. I want to leave you with this one thought. I love this line in scripture. I have loved this line for years and years and years, and I've had it ministered in my life and other people's lives for years and years and years, and it's this line in verse 17. The heavens open up, the dove comes down, and the Father speaks over. The voice came from heaven saying, this Jesus is my beloved Son in whom I well please. And my prayer today and my prayer this last week has been that this verse would minister to you afresh as it has done for me for years. And how's that? It's this one thought. Every son, every daughter, in this place, every son, every daughter that is hearing these words needs to hear the voice of the Father speaking over your life, speaking the words, this is my beloved son. This is my beloved daughter. You're my son, and I love you. You're my daughter, and I cherish you. You're my son, and I'm so well pleased in you. You know, as a father, I find it really easy to love my kids, even when they do bad things. I'm crazy about them. And it's like, oh, you messed up, but guess what? I love you. I'm so crazy about you. And guess what? I'm pleased. Not about the thing you set on fire, but listen. I'm pleased in you as a person. And it's something, parents, I just want to say this. I know so many of you, we have so many good parents in here. But it's something I just think, man, we need to keep repeating to our kids. Not because it's right to do it, but because it's in our hearts. That is, man, I am crazy about you. Man, my boys are like, hey, Dad, you want me to be a preacher one day? I'm like, if God wants you to be a preacher, sure. I want you to be who God wants you to be. I don't really care what you do, you know, unless you support that soccer team that I hate. But other than that, but hear my heart, guys. We need to hear these words as a son, as a daughter. Hey, God is saying to you today, I am well pleased in you. You're my beloved son. You're my beloved daughter. Do you know that God is pleased with you? Do you know that God says, in whom I'm well pleased over your life? Do you know that God is so in love with you? And see, the purpose of life, if you got a pen, jot this down. The purpose of life is to enjoy the fact that God is always enjoying you. There it is to enjoy the fact that God is always enjoying you. We always, it's really easy for us, where are you at, task-driven, A-type people, anybody? Okay. Driven people, you need a plan. You're like, tell me the purpose to make it, we need to make it a job, or even building the kingdom is a great purpose. But Jesus, more simply, in Matthew 17, said that they would know you. And by doing so, they'd know the love of the Father. The purpose of life, and I've come through this kind of understanding where it used to be like what we do for God. And now I believe it's just enjoying God's love for us. And that it's a response. That we're not the initiators. I used to read my Bible like an initiator, you know, like finding stuff to do for God. Instead of how God wants me to read it, which is as a respondent to what God's already done for me. That is a change. If you've never had that change here and here, pray for it today. Ask the Spirit to come upon your life and get a fresh filling of the Spirit of the living God. And just bask in the fact that today as you walk out from here, just bask in the fact that He says over your life, you're my son in whom I'm well pleased. You're my beloved. You're my daughter and I love you. I'm pleased in you. Stop trying to please me. Just enjoy the fact that I am enjoying you.